hold on. Oh, is this the text?
All right, okay. So
that is. Oh, that is actually like.
Why would you do that?
Wait, don't read it.
I can read it.
Don't.
Don't worry.
No, no, don't read it.
Yeah, I can't.
So
I can't if I wanted to.
Hang on, I will generate what needs to be done.
Because I can read this.
No, I don't want you to. Right. We'll. I have an idea. All right, just need a sec.
Oh, you sneaky little like.
Oh, wait, you talk about him? Because I was about to say, we can talk about the fact that this message is quite loaded. This is the one that's directed at us.
That's why I'm saying you sneaky.
Like, specifically EFAP, or...
I would almost certainly say it's almost specific. Well, you could judge it when we get to it. So, the thing about this, that it's just like, he's like... He wants it to be said, but he doesn't want to have to deal with someone responding to it, okay? It's like this weird world he lives in where he's like,
because he's coward? Yeah. He's a coward?
I was going to use that word, and then you used it, and now I'm going to talk about how, yeah, I was going to use that word. Yeah, that's about right.
Oh, okay.
So, I was just saying, it wouldn't be the first time. It's sneaky. It's very sneaky, like, doing this, having really thin, tiny texts to actually take a shot at somebody.
So,
but why even have it there? Like, what?
Well, it'll all make sense in terms of, like, he's at the point of... He just laid out a whole bunch of what is so meaningful about the show, but I think by talking about Isaiah, there's a clear, like, oh, shit, none of that makes any sense, though. And so now, he wants to address those who are like, ew, this doesn't make sense, though. This is going to be directed at. So, I think this could be amusing.
Okay.
Where are you? That's probably good enough. Alright, so... I'm gonna read it all out in one big go for chat, and then we will go through it, okay?
Okay.
But I'm gonna have background for it. I think is suitable. And so I guess you guys should probably mute and just watch the stream for the next. Well, it ends with thank you for watching. So as soon as you hear that, you can jump back in.
Oh, okay. Okay. Let me go to thing. Press live. Okie dokie. All
right. Here we go, chat. Do it. That background. I don't believe in bad. It didn't work for you. That's totally cool. But what if it did work for somebody? What if a different audience member watched this and had a profound response to it? Is that still bad? Why do so many critics only focus on the script elements that don't work for them when film is a visual medium? Composition, lighting, movement, rhythm, color, and 1,000 more visual elements are used to give you a feeling, to elicit an emotion. When we don't feel that intended feeling, we too often consider it bad. I used to use bad a lot, and I am totally guilty of still using it too much. But when it comes to art, someone's form of expression, a wonderful collaboration of people who put their souls into their work, can we stop acting like it's a piece of meat to be judged? I read too many comments. I see too many other artists on this platform that ridicule and mock those who passionately express their love for something. Why are we mocking those who share their love? There is nothing that comes from spewing hate and then hiding that hate behind critique. I'm still learning this lesson. It's fun being a dick and roasting something. But there are always people behind the writing you read, the videos you watch, the art you consume. And no artist has ever set out to make something that gets called bad by idiots like myself on YouTube. If somehow you read all of this, thank you. Thank you for watching.
Oh, yeah.
Any moment.
Is that the end of that?
That is it.
Oh, okay.
So halfway wow, what a little through, bitch. I was like kind of okay, but then when he started doing the attacks, I was actually kind of getting a little bit annoyed.
It's
yeah, he's a coward, but I don't like tactically. I don't get why you would put this here, so that. Well, why?
I think it is just the thing of like, because if he was just to say it out loud, then it's like really easy to attack that. But because it's this really small thing of text, it's almost like you're attacking somebody, but not, you know, you can
like,
kind of
like it reduces the chances that someone will respond to it.
Can I
just, yeah, I think it's indirect. You know what I mean?
First thing I want you guys to see after hearing all of that is this. This came after his video's release, by the way.
Oh, wow. You so, can't be consistent on this.
So you just shat on everything you just said, Alex. Like, yeah. I don't know what to tell you there.
I'm
reading
Immortal Hulk and am now realizing just how bad Hulk fans have it when it comes to the flicks. What do you mean?
Wow.
What do you mean bad?
He's like, saying that the film is... Yo, wait, what are you talking about? Endgame dab? They didn't intend to make that and have it be bad. They were trying and it was something. They had acting, visuals, framing, color... And they weren't trying to make something bad. There was a person behind that. There were a lot of people behind that high top. How dare you?
They put a lot of passion into
it's
their
insane.
Work. Yeah.
Guys, nobody believes this. Nobody believes when they say this whole thing of like everything is whatever you want it to be. Nobody believes that. You can push everybody to a certain point where they will concede that there is some level of craft to anything. You're never going to find somebody who's doing that, because if they do that, they basically don't even live in the world that we live in. They're just listing around everything is everything and can be anything, and there's no such thing as good or bad. There's nobody like that.
They would be... If people were critical, I guess is what I'm trying to say, because people are not critical of media. They're very easy to fool. If everyone was actually good at dissecting this stuff and looking at it, then people like High Top, they'd be out of a fucking job.
Yes.
Like, they'd be doing something else. They'd be fucking supersizing your fries or doing something they're good at. I don't know. They wouldn't be doing this. The only reason that these creators exist is because people are not critical in any way and because people are super duper easy to fool. So they rely on it all being whatever.
Mm-hmm. Because if there's a standard, everything is whatever. You don't need to make arguments. You can just say what you feel and nobody can criticize you. But like, what is the point of this? What do you do that is better than or worse than what anybody else does? When you look at any video that you make, how can you say that you've improved? If anything is anything, you can't improve. It's all as bad or good as each other. Your videos from like 4 years ago were totally fine. There's no such thing as bad. You said
they were perfect.
What if somebody came up to you, High Top, and was like, oh, you know, that video that you probably hate now? Oh, that really hit me in the feels, like emotionally, or that got me. And then you said that it was bad, and they're like, oh, man, that really upsets me because, like, I extract value from that. That does something for me. And, like, now, if you operate by the standard of there's your reaction to something, which can't really be invalidated ever.
Which isn't
like,
even
you can't
a standard.
Invalidate. Well, yeah, it's not a standard. It's just how you felt, which can't be invalidated because you felt it. Like, I feel like you don't even need to explain this. What you feel can't be invalidated because you felt it. The fact that you had that feeling, that's just something that happened.
Yeah, maybe your emotions aren't something concrete enough or reliable enough to put that much reliance in. Maybe some kids need to be told when they're growing up that just because you feel something doesn't mean that it's good or accurate or deserving of your emotion. Maybe just because you cried at something, maybe whatever it was didn't really deserve that tear from you.
I feel like it comes back to the whole thing we were talking way earlier, where it's like, you felt stuff, figure out why, and then they do, and they make a video like this, and it's like, okay, so you fucked up many times. You've not identified why you felt what you felt. You've identified why you think you felt what you felt, because that shit didn't happen. Either that, or you actually have no idea. Like, maybe I'm operating with too much good faith here, and you just didn't spot any of the bullshit in the show. And so, you know, like, the transaction's complete, they saw the scene, they've gotten the feeling from experiencing what they thought the scene was, then they watch it again after we talk about it, and they're like, okay, you're right, yeah, there's lots of bullshit in here, and I'm not getting the same emotional experience I was before, and that is, like, a fucking annoying experience for a lot of these people. Like, you just stole that from me. That's the meme, it's like, you've stolen my emotions.
Yeah, yeah, you're destroying art.
You stole it from yourself because you realized something.
Because you grew. Like,
yeah, you identified something that changes how you feel about the original. Just because you feel something, that is so weird. The idea that you felt it at that moment, and that is like the valid thing forever. Like, that's it. You just that's the final say on what it meant to you.
Maybe, just maybe, the reason why you look back at the things that you used to do and the things that you used to feel, and it makes you cringe and you feel ashamed of it, is because you've grown as a person and you're better now than you used to be.
Mm-hmm. Which is totally possible. And indeed, you probably ought to be cringing when you look back in the past. If you're not cringing, it means you haven't changed enough, I don't think.
Yeah, my behavior when I was a child or when I was growing up or when I was a dumb teenager is just as acceptable as my behavior now, and I see nothing wrong with what I did. Don't know how many people can say that, and it's a good thing.
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm just rereading, like, why do so many critics focus on script elements that don't work for them when film is
well,
a visual
do we
medium?
Want to go well, through
well, yeah,
it?
Well,
now,
well, yeah, well, well, yeah.
Well, shall we? Shall we go through it?
We will, we will. I guess if there's anything else before we do that, I was just going to say that I just love this image that it came right after his video, because he not only does he use the word bad, but he's talking about a project that many people worked on. He's just like, bad. Like,
yeah.
Okay.
Like thousands of people.
So, like, I guess it's a really great way to start, because, like, no matter what you actually pulled from his comment here, he doesn't believe in it. So, if you thought it was, like, insightful, or if he was actually going to pay attention to it, it's like, no. There is a note where he's like, I'm still, you know, not quite great at doing it yet, and it's like, oh, as if he doesn't fucking know that he's doing this every single time he says anything is bad. And, yeah, I guess the rest of the commentary will come when we'll just go through it piece by piece.
Well, even if he's right or wrong, he's certainly confident enough to say that something is bad.
So this is, I guess, the funny part about words. They would basically say, like, whenever I say good or bad, I mean I liked it and I didn't like it. However, in their scripts, they will often describe things that they liked and didn't like, and then they will describe something as this one, this is best, this is good, this is great. And it's like, sounds like you're making a difference there. What is it? And then they go, oh, it's just that I like it a lot.
Well, that's what we asked Twin Perfect. How do you differentiate between the things that you think are better than others? Because we had to get there, because good and bad don't work, because he can't face reality. So we have to baby step our way to, how do you just differentiate two things that, where you think one is better? Why is one better than the other? And it's just a question you refuse to answer, because they know they can't. That's the forbidden zone. If I go down this path, I'll have to admit that I actually do have a standard, maybe deep down, that I just have been... It's like my id. Like, standards are that monster inside of me, that feral part of myself that I've grown past, and I'm more sophisticated than it, and I can't actually address it, because then everything crumbles after that. It's too foundational, so I have to ignore it. I have to compartmentalize that into some part of my psyche as best as I can, and train myself to not think about it.
Hence why...
But you need to go head on.
Hence why I've always felt that whether or not you even fucking... remotely agree with how we assess stuff, at least we've stayed consistent on what the words mean.
Yeah.
You actually understand what we're saying when we say it to you, whether or not you,
you
know, like, the way we describe them, what words or whatever, it's like, it's barely relevant compared to, you understand exactly what we're saying.
If, I guess an example would be, wait, what the fuck was I even gonna say? I don't know. Carry on. That was weird. I literally just had a mental reset. I was, oof, that's weird.
I suppose we can get into it.
Let me use the loo real quick and top off my drink before we get into it. Right. Probably gonna need some
cold juice down my throat.
Yeah, and I know that's hard to read everybody, but that again is because he shoved it into a really quick part of the video and a really tidy writing, and I don't know any other reason that he's just like, yeah, I want to say this, but I don't really want it to be a big thing. You
but
better.
It's gonna be a big thing, buddy.
Well, I mean, I've got so much to say about all of it. It's so horribly written.
Yeah.
It's gonna be great.
I guess.
Sneaky.
You're not. It doesn't. This is not. Yeah. Let's just we'll go through it. Need to take it piece by piece, because when I was listening to it halfway through, I'm like, ah, this is pretty standard. But then, once the second half started, I was actually getting annoyed.
Well, it's funny because, like, the overall vibe you get from messages like this are a sense of, please reduce the toxicity, but they're always very toxic. They always shove stuff in there that's very, like goblin
little activates. Little things to sneak in, like, yeah, getcha, I'm gonna getcha.
Yeah, I'm particularly interested in the part where he says, can we stop acting like it's a piece of meat to be judged? When he's praising things, it's like, do you know what you're doing when you praise something?
You're judging it.
Like a piece of meat.
And what it...
How you doing, chat? We're at 5.5 hours, we've still got 2.5 videos to go.
Christ. Man.
I know,
especially... It always happens.
The opening as well, being like, oh, how could you even do this for 11 hours, you weirdos? It's like, I know.
It takes a level of, endurance, I guess.
I like that someone said, damn, this is some good steak. What the fuck is wrong with you? From, apparently, this guy. It's just like, well, that's the realization. What he means to write here is, you're allowed to praise stuff, don't criticize it. That's the true part of it, but you know
which
that no
one... Which
is
a really frustrating one.
Yeah, nobody wants to actually say that, because that sucks. It's like, wait, what do you mean? That just means we have to be dishonest now. And inherent in a praise is an implication of a criticism, as in the opposite equaling the opposite result, right? I think we went over this with the whole, like, I think this is really good because it is consistent with this other thing. And you're like, so it would have been bad if it was inconsistent? And then you just have to be silent. You're like, I wouldn't comment either way on that. Nope. All I do is praise.
I guess
stuff.
I've always found it really annoying. Because I remember having this the idea that if you have a perspective that's positive, it's just that's good. But if you have a perspective that's negative, you're opinionated. Despite the fact that both of them are opinions, but like having positive views on something, that's just totally fine. And you know what? Negativity is called for sometimes. I want to tell you, sometimes there are merits to actually having things to say that aren't positive.
I think so too. And I think that it can be tough to get the kind of criticism you need because a lot of friends might not want to deliver it because they feel bad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You can't expect to improve at any enterprise, including a creative one, if you're unwilling to accept that you can potentially fuck it up. I think this idea that simply because you had an idea and that you expressed it means that it is impossible for you to have made any error at all is not the path to improvement for any person who does anything like this, whether it means writing or art or cinematography or photography or acting. The idea that there is no such thing as like good or bad acting, good or bad artwork. There's a reason why. If there was no good or bad, why would you even need to learn how to do it? How could you ever improve? What is the difference between Quentin Tarantino and just somebody who got their phone and whipped it out and recorded something? What distinguishes the two? Because experience means nothing.
Shawshank Redemption in the room, they're the same.
That's the thing. Nobody accepts that. Once you start actually comparing the best with the worst,
they'll do the exactly. Oh, come on.
Once you bring up The Room or Hitler, everyone's opinions are just
They'll do the thing though. They'll go, oh come on, oh come on now.
Yeah, as if oh come on is an argument. There are so many people who don't understand analogies. It really pisses me off. Analogies are so useful for figuring out what it is you actually think. And everybody gets really evasive and defensive anytime there's, that's absurd. It's like, that's the point.
Like, no, it's not. It's not absurd at all. I mean, they're the same. What do you mean? That's not absurd.
I was
going to
say, the example with Shawshank versus The Room isn't absurd at all. It's like, yeah, the two films are two stories. So Get to it. Tell me. Tell
two emotional stories about loss and
the group of people behind. And
you know, a man and his friends, and you know, justice, and I just, it's about family.
It's about family.
Oh and, boy.
Alrighty then. I'm fine with either of you looking to read this out if you wanna.
I can hold on. Let me. I need to lean closer. I don't believe in bad. But if it didn't work for you, that's totally cool.
I don't actually have a picture of it that I can read.
Oh, sorry.
So it says, I don't believe in bad. I don't believe in bad. If it didn't work for you, that's totally cool. But what if it did work for someone?
All right, so we're off to a bad start, I would say, because now we've locked bad in to mean not enjoyed by anybody, which is what Just Right thought
it
was.
Which is not what it means.
Yeah, so, like I said, the room and Hitler. Those are the only two examples that you'll probably ever need, really. You could always fall back to the room and Hitler.
Yeah.
It's great. You should try it at home. What if Hitler, right? You just plug him in. Plug him in the room in. What if it did work for someone? Well, what about all the stuff Hitler did that worked for him? What then? Well, that's absurd, Rags. That's ridiculous. Well, can you explain why, though? Because, well, what if a different guy, you know...
Well, I know what they would say. It wouldn't escape them, but it would get them to the next part of the argument. They would say, well, Hitler's a person, not like a piece of art.
Hmm?
They would say Hitler's
This would be like, what if the things that Hitler did work for him? Like, what if that was all right with him? What if he got an immense emotional resonance from that?
This is the thing, you've got to skip him down the yellow brick road, because there's going to be like, that's actions he took that I condemn morally. This is artwork. There's no one's being harmed with artwork.
Well, he's talking about the creation of films. Those are actions taken.
That you have to... I'm trying to think of how they would even get around this. I basically just want to skip them all the way down to like...
It's like entering into Bizarro world, isn't it?
Don't believe in bad. It's such a silly thing to say. But the something working for someone, I would just be like, so what if they've highlighted something? Let's go to the extreme, right? What if they highlight something that didn't actually happen in it? What do you do with that? You're like, well, that would never happen. It's like, no, I'm saying it did in this hypothetical. Someone said, like, I really loved it. Fucking, what did Jared say? He loved it when Rey killed Han Solo or something.
Yeah.
So... if I said a movie, the Force Awakens was bad because Rey killed Han Solo, well, what are you gonna, like, or I said it was good because of that.
I guess you'd have to tell them that didn't happen, and if they said hypothetically if that happened, then you just treat it like a hypothetical, and why that, but if that's something that they believed... I guess you'd have to convince them that didn't happen.
Well, I assume we're within the capacity to rewatch or use references, right? And then we'd be like, so it didn't happen. Now what? And if this was only ever about, like, we've done this plenty of times. Someone's like, okay, well, everything you brought up I think is valid, but I still like it. It's like, right.
Whatever. Okay, so I am correct. That's all I need. Thank you.
Like, as long as we're all on board with the same references, it's like, yeah, that's fine then.
If you agree that I'm correct with everything that I've said, and the implications you would think that you're also agreeing with, which I don't think so if you're saying that, but okay.
Yeah, bad and good.
But if you're going to like it no matter what, you're basically saying I like it no matter what. And if that's the case, what an immense devaluation of the things, of you liking
Hell yeah.
Media.
You'd think that they would be...
Like, what does that mean?
...structurally upon things of some kind. But maybe they can argue, it was about the actors. It stars my brother in it or something, so I just love it because I love seeing my brother act. And you're like, okay. That's like a different thing. It's not really a story you're appreciating there, is it? It's like nothing to do with it, actually. And at the same time, I always get amused by how everyone seems to assume that we all have the exact same definition of good and bad, when that's like one of the few words in the English language that have like a laundry list of possible definitions.
Yeah.
And are used in all contexts all the time for all kinds of different things. And yet he's like, so it can't be bad if someone else liked it. Which so many people say all the time.
7 billion people, someone's gonna like it.
And yeah, of course, as you said with Hitler, there's just easily we just have to figure out how he's defining this word with a couple of questions. That's all that would be.
Yeah.
And then we'd be able to contradict it because it's not going to be hard.
This contradicts the last video we watched. So much assertions and this is this and that's that and these are these. Like, boom, that falls apart.
Mm-hmm. Do you want to continue ringing or what is
that? With this particular thing.
I don't know if you want to say anything about it or not.
Well, it's just, you can react to a piece of content however you want. It's a different conversation. It's just unrelated. Like, yeah, you can feel whatever way you want, obviously, but that's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about the craft itself.
Mm-hmm.
Just feel like that was obvious, but I guess not. Like, that there is a difference.
But I feel like this is a bit of an EFAP 101 stuff. We come back to this every once in a while.
Yeah.
Back to the basics of some of these people.
Oh.
Moving right along.
Oh, next one. What if a different audience member watched this and had a profound response to it? Is it still bad? Yeah, potentially, because the profound response could just depend on your life experiences and stuff, which is fine, but it's a different conversation.
You could literally have hallucinated.
Well, what's funny is this is him trying to thoroughly explain his position. I'm like, all right, so I need you to define bad now, because you need to do that so that I can answer your question. If we were swap out bad for inconsistent storytelling, what if they had a profound response to it? Is it still inconsistent? It's like, yeah, categorically. Whether or not they find it profound wouldn't change that. Okay, but what if you had a prime response to it? Do you still consider it like an unethical product or something? I'd be like, I assume someone... I came to that conclusion irrelevant of whether or not they found it profound, so yes. And so
apparently he made that. So.
Yeah, but he would disown it now, but he'll keep it up because it's his most popular video.
He's such a hypocrite.
So,
it's so hard to keep track of his fucking positions.
And again, like, if someone experienced something profound,
well, I was gonna whatever my third one
means. Yeah, go ahead.
My third one was gonna be, is it if bad is defined as nobody had a profound response to it, would it still be bad if someone had a profound response to it? It's like, well, then it wouldn't be bad because that's how you've defined that word. Which feels to me how he's done this. He's baked bad into meaning the thing that isn't possible, and so stop saying it. And it's like, yeah, that's your problem, buddy. You've not really paid attention to what we even mean when we say bad.
Yeah, then all we have to do is just change our word. We could literally make up a word for it on the spot if we need to. Because we're getting, this is just a term thing.
Anyway.
Why do so many critics only focus on script elements that don't work for them when film is a visual medium? Because the script is the story at like its most fundamental level.
Also,
the visuals are the script is they. That's what it's the visual. What you that's you seeing the script is the visuals.
I tweeted about this the other day. Yeah. Like for some reason, these people think that when a character is like walking somewhere or pulling a lever, shooting stuff, it's like that's visuals. That's not writing. It's like of course that's visuals.
It is writing.
Of course that's visuals and writing. Visuals and writing are not these separate entities.
It's not dichotomous. Like, the writing is everything that happens. That is the writing is the story at its fundamental level. It's like this, because, I mean, you always boil it back, right? Like, just a person telling a story to somebody else is, like, fundamental writing, even though they haven't written it down. But then it's, like, book. That's, like, the most fundamental...
Yeah, that's why any we call story... it that, is because you write it all down.
Yeah, because it's wrote it down. It's like anything could be turned into like a book or the actual words written down on a piece of paper. And then like anything that you add on to that is like, it's expanding upon the fundamental idea that like whatever the story is, it is a bunch of words that are just on the page or like that somebody came up with and wrote down somewhere. Yeah, it's just a catch-all word for every, you know, sort of idea.
And then, of course, the good old visual storytelling. I'm going to give a lesser example and then a more, like, if we stray further away from, like, a concrete. So, if you have a story of a guy who's struggling to deal with the fact that he's much older than he was, like, we were tooling around with the idea for, like, a superhero that would do that, right? That could be a cool superhero story. He's really, really old. And there's loads of examples of other people have done it and stuff. I was just saying, like, you have that. Nowhere in the script is a scene that happens, but they came up with it on set and they decided to keep it in the edit where there's just a scene transition, he's getting up, and it was supposed to be that he gets up and goes into the kitchen or whatever, but he gets up and he's got a mirror, and he just, the camera's zooming slowly out, panning out, and he's just staring at it. And then we cut to him in the kitchen. And someone's like, see, you're not really considering that because you only talk about the writing. We're like, oh, that's part of the writing. I'd be talking about that. Yeah, that's something he did. That was an action he took. That was something we were shown. Yeah. And then, if they were able to finally concede on that, if we had, for example, I'm not referencing anything specific here, but if somebody's brain was falling apart, and at one part in the actual movie itself, there's a character who is drinking tea, and they drop their mug, and it smashes across the floor, and they're tearing up as they try and collect all of the pieces. If someone said, you can't judge that, because that's more metaphorical, it's not writing, I'd be like, what are you talking about? Like, of course you can fucking
how
tie that in.
How did the actress figure out that she was supposed to do that? If this was a woman. If it was a man, how would, you know, it's like... Like, so, how do they know to do these things?
I mean, and then... So I'm already baffled by, like, they think so much is left out if you're only... And they this, the word, the poisonous words, like, you only talk about plot. Can you stop using that? It makes it sound like we only talk about whether or not the correct amount of bullets were in a fucking gun. That's, it's like, it goes so far beyond just that.
Yeah, naturally. Oh, boy. Composition, lighting, movement, rhythm, color... and 1,000 more visual elements are used to give you a feeling, to elicit an emotion. Yeah, but how... Yeah, but, like, the writing is, like, the one inextricable element. Like, that's the one that you can't not have. You can have a scene that has, like, no... Like, that's pitch black, and if characters are talking, it still functions as a story. But, like, if it's just nothing at all... The writing is the one element that you can't do without. That's why books are a thing that can exist. It's just writing. It is just writing, and there is still a story. You remove the visuals, it becomes like a radio thing.
You
remove the audio, it becomes a book. Yeah, you don't.
You can tell stories to blind people.
Yep.
Yep.
You can tell stories to deaf people.
And so, when we start stripping it away, and he's like, you take these one by one. He's like, composition. I'm like, so be specific. And he's like, oh, well, so how they frame the camera in these hallways to make it look really narrow and the characters in the center to sort of imply like the world is coming in on them or like a claustrophobia. I'd be like, you can talk about that in writing. You wouldn't have to necessarily say that that's strictly composition and non-writing. I don't know why you said this.
Yeah, because you can
again, metaphor,
like,
representative.
You can achieve each of the payoffs in different ways. Yeah, and it's the same with like audio cues. Because, I mean, a lot of like what the... Because writing can achieve this as well through tapping into, for lack of a better word, the kinesthetic aspects of, like, human experience. Because you've got audible and visual, but, like, books tend to have to use words to get into, to like, transmit the feeling that they want you to have into your
head. Yeah, the information has to get into your brain somehow.
Yeah, in a subconscious way. So, like, you can write it in a way that makes people get goosebumps or makes people sort of like, oh, shit, something's ramping up and makes their heart race. And all of that is, again, it comes down to any story could be translated into a, like, a book. And if that's the case, like, it can be translated into words, that is the one, that's it. Like, that's the core of it. And that's not to undermine any of the other elements of, like, filmmaking or visual, like, in terms of music or, like, cinematographers or anything like that. Those are all important. It's just the idea that, like, at the fundamental level, there is the story that is written down somewhere. Even if it's just in someone's head, it's still written down.
Yes, right. Think of writing in a not like necessarily ink on pages.
No,
yeah, it's more abstract.
That's right.
It's, for lack of a better term, writing.
It's the ability that humans have to craft a concept or craft some sort of sequence. The abstract thoughts that you have that create a sequence of events.
So the one I'm super interested in is lighting specifically, right? So you have a character at a bar, and they sort of move forward to speak to a character, and they've got light on one side of their face, and the other side is shadow, and this is a person that can't quite be trusted, they lie, they backstab, so you're like, ah, I see. However, if you have something like that, and then Hightop is like, oh man, I just, oh, I feel, it just looks so good. And you're like, what about it? Like, what are you sort of picking up from it that you really enjoy? And he goes, no, I just like the way that it's lit. I'd be like, okay. So that's shallow as fuck. Like, that's fine.
Yeah, it's like, okay, yeah, whoever did that did a, yeah,
and
sure.
Don't Don't mistake me, right? If you were like, wow, so it's just shout a like a visual now, I'd be like, I mean, kind of. Like, there's plenty kind of stuff I like the way that it looks, and I'll say that. I just go, yeah, I just like the way that it looks. Doesn't necessarily make
less
me think
shallow
of anything.
If you had a lot of really good reasons, and
I don't think that should be something we should be upset about or something. Like, a shot of a sunset could be just a shot of a sunset. It's like, yeah, it's really gorgeous. You're like, yeah, all right. But in a particular movie, at a particular point or storyline, you'd be like, no, this represents, and then you go on for a while about why it's so important and impactful. And I would just argue, it's like, oh yeah, you know, that's a much more thorough reasoning, which is what people would do for the binary sunset with Luke at TLJ. But the counters would be the story, you know.
You'd be like, yes, this visual is it's like your emotions. Like, maybe that thing is not earned.
And I think it can happen that you feel a certain way about something. Someone gives you a reason why that might be, and if that is the only one you have, you're just like, yeah, you know what, this is the reason. And the reason I bring that up is that someone is like, oh, I love that binary sunset. And it turns out the whole reason is just it looks nice. It's like, I really like the look of it. I really like the composition of it. And someone else says, oh, it's because of them. Then they just label all this shit that happens in the story. And that person goes, that is the reason I like it. Yeah. And then someone else goes, none of that made any sense. All that's incongruent. They omitted so many things and they made up some things. They'll just be like, fuck you. I like the sunset. Shut up. And it's like, calm down. You can still like it. I didn't do anything to you liking
it.
Yeah,
I like it.
Yeah, we're not talking about whether or not you like it, though. That's
different. It just gets attached.
The way that you like different things might be like weighed differently.
Naturally,
you know, like the way that I.
Go ahead.
The way that I appreciate the, let's say, the story and the characters and the prestige. Not everything has to be on the same. Like I could look for you go outside. Oh, that's a pretty leaf. Mm-hmm. You know, you go outside. Oh, it's a pretty leaf. Right, I don't like that in the same way that I like or that I value a very tight script.
Yeah,
well, something think, very meaningful.
I think it's kind of funny now that I think about it. It's almost ironically arrogant to assume that like the way that you personally respond to something is worth more than somebody trying to do it in a clinical way. Well, not clinical, but. Trying to do it in a way
analytical
reasoned.
Yeah, analytical I think is better, because I'm thinking now, like, why is it that Wall-E is my favorite Pixar movie? It's like, well, I actually think it's the best, but I think Wall-E has advantages that other films don't, because I really like space. So when I see him flying around in space, it's a great sequence, but like, it's enhanced more for me because I personally just like space. And that's not really worth anything on its own. Like, if I were just to say that, that doesn't really mean anything. Like,
it's more
I
informative
like
about you than the film.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, that's kind of what I'm getting at, is if I made a video where I was just talking about that, I would need to do better than just saying, I like space, so seeing space makes this good, or makes it meaningful to me. In the same way that you look at that, like, I like snow settings. I like those settings. So it wouldn't mean anything that if a story but if a story was set in like that area and it just appeals to me more, that doesn't mean anything. That shouldn't necessarily mean anything to anybody else. Why would I assume that it would mean anything to anybody else just because I personally like it?
And that's different than if you said, I like this sequence in Wall-E because I like space and zero gravity and the whatever it is you like about space that you could nail down if you could, because you don't know why you like or dislike everything you like or dislike. Mm-hmm. But theoretically saying, I like this sequence in Wall-E because I just really like space stuff. That would be different than saying, I like this conversation that these two characters have because of, and you give a reason that's just incorrect. Or I like this plot element because remember last scene where he pulled that lever and when that didn't happen or that was incorrect or it's just you're not remembering it. Explaining why you like two different things, not necessarily on the same level, especially if they're just objectively wrong.
And I think the reason why I brought that up is because I read ahead to the next sentence and it's me thinking about how sometimes it's that the person who made the work might not have been able to even comprehend that you would respond to something in such a way because it's just based on your personal experience. And that's great. And that's like one of the really, that's a really cool thing about storytelling and art in general, is the idea that it can hit you in ways that doesn't necessarily hit other people because of your life experience or your values. Like, that's great. But you follow up to the next sentence where it's, when we don't feel the intended feeling, we too often consider it bad. I think it's important to make a distinction, and this is something I've been thinking about because I think I want to talk about it maybe in a video. Like, suspension of disbelief is not, it's not like something that when you enter into a story, there is an understanding that it's like not real or that it's, well, yeah, that it's not a real thing that happened. But you enter into that story almost like there's an almost unspoken agreement between the person who made the story and the person entering into it of, I am going to treat this as legitimate, for lack of a better word. Like, I am going to approach this with the understanding that that it can affect me in a way that something that isn't real logically shouldn't, because it's doing something well in terms of, you know, hitting all the beats. And that, and then it's, you go into it and you give it kind of the benefit of the doubt, is kind of what suspension of disbelief is in a certain sense. And there's only so many times that it can contradict what you understand to be the way that reality works, that it's like, oh, it's broken, it's done, like it's collapsed, it's over.
I don't know about calling it reality. Like,
I mean, like, cause and effect. That's kind of what I mean. Like, your understanding of the way, in that sense.
I don't mean reality in the sense of...
Yeah, so I don't mean things like there are spaceships or magic, because you can buy into that if that's all consistent. I mean, the idea that you can even understand what's happening by understanding that...
Internally coherent.
Yeah, internally coherent in the way that it makes sense. A connects to B connects to C, and you can deal with some of those snaps, but there's only so many until it's like, oh, I just can't take this seriously anymore. Like, it's over. It's broken. Yeah, it's utterly collapsed. It's now into bad. It failed at what it was meant to do.
And what's key about that would be, they tell us something is something, and they tell us something is also not something. Well, now I'm stuck. I can't have both. You have to tell me which one it is.
Yeah, you can only play along, which is essentially what suspension of disbelief is. Yeah, I'm going to play along. Yeah. Right. We're agreeing that I'm going to play along with your with your fictional whatever it is, or with your account, because the story is an account of a series of events. Eventually that breaks, you know. Now where that is different for different people. I should hope that outright contradictions affect everyone. I would hope that. Clearly it doesn't. I wish that it sort of did, in a way.
To bolster you quickly, the reason why I would want people to value it is because the value they got in the first place was coherency, right? Like, things building on each other. If they value that process, then surely they devalue the process of it breaking. Surely.
You have to. It's just, it's dichotomous, kind of, and that's, yeah.
Because you don't value everything the same, and there's reasons for that. You might not know them, and you're not obligated to know them, but it would probably be helpful if you did. Like, there's a lot of things, in especially because we were talking about earlier, you know, a beautiful sunset or that's just really pretty for a lot of people. And I don't know why it is. It just seems to be the case that it is. And similar things seem to also be very appealing visually. But I couldn't tell you why.
Yeah.
I mean, there is a reason in my brain why it works, but I don't know.
Well, beauty is complicated, because remember, because there is no such thing as beautiful, like, in the universe. Like, the universe just is. Like,
yeah, when beauty is a value we imbue on things, yeah.
Yeah, and it kind of applies to, like, the way that we approach, but stories are a bit complicated, because the idea of a story is like a human concept. Like, story is kind of what you impose on just a sequence of events. And
yeah, a story requires an agent. Yeah, it's not, there's not a, stories don't exist without minds.
Yeah, exactly. And it applies the same way. And like, well
the creation of them, not, just to be clear, the creation of stories. Yeah, if we all died, books would still exist.
Books would still exist, but their meaning ceases to exist without people. But it's just the whole idea that the way that we understand the universe to be is that it's cause and effect. Like, we don't operate the way that we do without cause and effect. The idea that this can cause that, that there is past, present, and future. And so a story needs that, because if it doesn't, again, it's like Bob went to the shops. He didn't have legs. Bob walked to the shop. He didn't have legs. He got the food, the end. It's like there is something there that just doesn't, that story doesn't function anymore.
I have questions, yes. I have questions about your tale, yeah.
As opposed to Bob walked to the shops. He had legs. He bought some food. It's like, you can see that. Like, you can see that story happening.
I just like the idea. It's like, needed to let you know he had legs. You're like, I figured, but okay.
It was a short story called Knock. And I think it's like the shortest. It's generally regarded as how can you tell a super short story, which is the last man on earth sat alone in his room. There was a knock on the door. And it's two sentences. It's super short. You don't have all the information you need. Clearly, is it delusional? Is there something out there? It doesn't have to be complex, and you don't have to have all the information. And there's so much you could do with it as well, with just even that as a premise. We're talking about,
we're having big fun.
I feel like all of this would be lost on high top. I think,
well, too, but you need this. This is like your base.
This is what we're all talking about here. Is like, as well, because I can picture someone being like, "Oh my god, get on with it." Or like, you don't understand. This is all of the like foundational stuff before. This is what we're all working with. This is all like the gears behind all of the statements we make in terms of.
This is the unspoken, underlying truths, almost. You know, that you just have to.
His mistake.
And it's not complicated either. It really isn't complicated. You just have to. Think about it, which you normally don't have to ever do. You never have to think about it, because generally for most people, stories are just presented to them in their full packaging, and so you don't have to look at the ingredients label, but it helps to
about it. The mistake he's made as well, right? So he's got like, when we don't feel the intended feeling, we too often consider it bad. I think this is even almost an echo of the Wonder Woman 84 stuff. So the artist intended for it to be cute that they slept together as a thing, they managed to come back, and that's going to inform how sad it is that they have to, you know, split apart. The director incompetently forgot that was not his body that he was inhabiting. So if you can understand that, then understand that the feeling you should be having is like one of, you know, kind of like, oh, yay, sort of joy. You shouldn't be having horror. And so just because you felt horror does not then make it bad. And I would just be fascinated. I'd just be like, High Top, how far can we push this before even you would crack? Like, what can I do in a film while claiming that I want... This all relies on fucking third-party testimony in terms of what the story is, by the way.
We don't have access to absolute truth, capital T, but, you know, justified true belief is a thing that we could hopefully agree upon as interlocutors in this conversation.
But the other,
and if you can't do that with someone, then just don't even fucking have a conversation with them. They just don't waste your time. You ain't getting anywhere.
But like, first of all, obviously death of the author, which he would absolutely subscribe to. There's no fucking, like, I can't believe we met Twin Perfect. I stand by what I said to him when he first said it. I was like, you don't believe that. Nobody does. I'm sorry, you don't. Nobody would.
Which is why he refused to go down any of those pathways.
Yeah,
he knew. He was just smart enough to know that we can't go there, because I know where this might lead.
The other way he's kind of fucked this up is that he thinks that I'm like, oh man, Falcon Winter Soldier, Wonder Woman 84, I don't like this because I didn't get the intended feeling. And I'm like, oh, I wasn't even talking about my feelings. I was just talking about how incongruent it is with itself. That's it. Like, that's my intention. I try. Obviously, I involve my personal feelings here and there. Like, I do consider it morally reprehensible to rape somebody. I'm a bit weird like that. I know that a lot of people don't share that sentiment, but that's fine. You know, everyone's different. I just think that when focusing on inconsistencies, a delivery that would be like, yep, this story is just failing to do the one fucking thing a story is supposed to do. And he's like, well, that's just how you feel. I'd be like, well, no. Like, how it makes me feel emotionally, I haven't even told you about that yet. I might very much enjoy it. We bring this back up all the fucking time, but, like, there's so many movies that are just nonsense that I love.
That's one of those. That's why, like, one of the most core foundational aspects of EFAP is your subjective enjoyment of something pretty much come from anywhere, regardless of whether it's good or not, as it applies to, you know, an objective standard.
And you might think a hard bullet to bite on this one would be, well, then, of course, Mauler, Rags, Fringy, you would advocate, you should be gunning for cause and effect then, so we'll never have movies like a Batman and Robin, or a maybe Mortal Kombat, or Godzilla vs. Kong, where they're really just nonsense, stupid, crazy things can happen. And I would just be like, well, no, it's more so you can tell with each project you're making, right? Like, if you're making a Falcon and the Winter Soldier type, and you're not gunning for, like, absolute... You're trying to make a coherent A to B story. If you're trying to make us laugh through the lack of A to B coherent storytelling, we'll probably be able to detect that from the movie. We're going to be pretty fucking obvious, because it's going to be, like, more than likely a comedy.
Yeah. Also, this assumes we're going to get to a perfect world.
Yeah, the interesting thing is, if I was on set for like, a comedy that was absurdist, and they were like, right, we can have it so that, you know, he packed his hairdryer instead of his gun, because he's an incompetent detective, and then we're going to have it so that he fires it, and a bullet actually comes out and kills somebody. Does that make sense? And I'd be like, well, no, but that sounds kind of funny. Like, so I don't know, I wouldn't be against putting it in. I'd have to see how it looks, I guess. But so I was like, wow, that betrays all the thing about storytelling, right? It's like, well, it's trying to commit humor. So if we're talking about something as serious as, like, race issues, like, political, will, geopolitical upheaval, and, like, moral advice and stuff, it's like, yes, you better be getting pretty fucking close to cause and effect at this point. Otherwise, yeah, this is all just going to fall apart. There's nothing it rests on. But everyone's emotional reactions are going to be different, even with we've talked about, like, the perfectly coherent film and the entirely incoherent film. It doesn't mean everyone's going to react to both of those according to that. It's just, we're talking about
the same person can have contradictory viewpoints over time. Like, they, yep. Like, you can forget, like, what happened. This would be useful for Death of the Author stuff. What if someone makes something and they tell you what it's made of or what it's about? A bunch of time goes by, they forget what they meant by it, and so they make another claim about what it's about, and it's different this time. It's not they weren't lying, they just forgot, and they have maybe this is in an odd way a sort of quasi blessing, but they have become legitimately the audience, and they have forgotten what they, you know, sort of did. I mean, what then? I mean, which of their feelings was, you know, are they both true, even though they can't coexist, or what? How does that get resolved? What about a hallucination? How, when someone feels something about a thing, but they hallucinated a scene from the film, or they misremember it?
Just unreliable memory.
Come
yeah.
to just disagree with yourself. You're like, ah, you know what? I was wrong in the past. This is what I actually think now.
Well, that's always the funny one, because they'll make, like, a huge emotional video, and then a year later they're like, actually, it doesn't really work for me anymore. I'm just like, but so so which take is the take? They're like, they're both correct. But it's like, but they use different reasoning. It's like, the contradictive reasoning. They're like, yeah, well, deal with it, motherfucker. Like, okay.
Well, as we're about to see in sentence number...
Oh, well, yeah. One more thing I want to say was, somebody said, yeah, like, we still wouldn't want to discount the emotional aspect, as in, like, we've been over this before, but, you know, the chair in the room story... If anybody made it and said, hey, you three, can you judge the, like, cause and effect of it? And if we concluded it was absolutely sound, I would then be like, you do get no one's going to like this, right? No one's going to give a shit. It's a chair in a room. There might be one guy who writes a review about how it means, like, all these different things, but, like, you might want to have characters, you might want to have things happen. And if someone said, wait, so you're saying I have to have things happen to have my story? It's like, no, but, I mean, well, actually, I'm not even sure... We would have to start getting into the weeds of exactly what it means to be a story, but you probably get what I mean. Something very quick and mundane. We wouldn't recommend it, even though it would be sound, because that's not, like, the only component of trying to appeal to someone's emotions, because that's a completely different fucking topic. The classics of have a dog and then have it die, or have a, you know, like a family member perish in some horrible accident when they were younger, you know, just all the standard ways. We all are very aware of how to manipulate audiences, or if you... properly justify it with writing. I wouldn't call it manipulative. I guess that's where, like, the hero's journey and stuff like that comes into it. Loads of writing advice for standard sort of story structures, which is also important if you want to make people like your story instead of just telling whatever you wanted to tell. But my god, you need it to fucking make sense.
And I think what we see a lot of the times in we see it a lot of times with everything, basically, with the videos we cover on EFAP. For people constantly go into, you're looking too deep into the plot, you're looking too deep into the story, don't think about it, not everything has to make sense, not everything has to be plot. But constantly on our EFAP videos that we watch and respond to, people are, TLJ is a perfect example. TLJ is a fucking apex example. Whether it's the Luke arc, whether it's the space chase, whether it's any element of the plot that doesn't make any sense, defenders of that film would try and make sense of it. They would try and make it work. They would come, even if it required them, because this happens all the time, they invent scenes that don't happen,
mm-hmm.
or they try and just create details that aren't there. They will try and make sense out of things, because deep down they want things to make sense.
Yeah.
Even if it's wrong, even if they have to make stuff up, it needs to make sense.
Well,
they even believe deep down that if it doesn't make sense, that's not good.
Quick example would be, he loves that Falcon had money troubles. If we had him here, I'd be like, what do you mean by that? Well, that he couldn't afford certain things, and it was giving him trouble based on having a lack of money. And then we could just keep poking until we find out the mechanics, and then the mechanics won't be lining up with how it works in the world, and then he'll have to admit, yeah, okay, it doesn't make a lot of sense, but I like that he has money troubles, and then we've exposed how shallow it is. It's literally just that there's money problems.
Yes. It's just a poor... So, it just...
Him being poor.
Be poor. Yeah, you be poor.
Which, to be honest, any of you out there that loved his takes on Spider-Man, because Spider-Man needs to be poor, I just want you to realize that's how shallow it is. Like, it has nothing to do with the story. He just needs to be poor.
Give it up.
Y'all need to get a grip, man.
Give it up.
Gotta be better than that. Yeah.
The next sentence is, I used to use bad a lot, and I'm totally guilty of still using it too much, but when it comes to art, someone's form of expression, a wonderful collaboration of people who put their souls into their work, can we stop acting like it's a place a piece of meat to be judged? Well, I mean, you are going to judge it on some level, whether or not you think you are.
I have a feeling, even with that being said, well, you're probably going to say that the Holocaust wasn't that great.
Oh, well, I guess
they're just
going
to want you to reference actual art,
level,
though. Like, not a... they're going to be pissed
when you
if you reference
trailer,
that.
When you watch a trailer and go, you're judging it.
Yeah, congratulations. Well, this video, it's a literal video where this is from. He's judging it.
Yeah, you're judging it, just favorably. But you don't understand that judge is a neutral word. Judgment is neutral. It is not positive or negative.
Yep.
Nor is criticism.
I suppose it's interesting to think about, like, to be judged like a piece of meat, there's a bit of connotation there, like it's, you're reducing it down from what it may have been. I'd just be like, is that only when we criticize it? Is that kind of what he's getting at there? Not that when we praise it? Because when you praise it, it's no longer a piece of meat. It's like it's a wonderful sculpted piece of meat on a pedestal.
Yeah.
Very odd commentary from him, because inherent in any praise is going to be an assumption of what would have been critical. An example, I guess, of this would be life drawing, right? If someone drew an incredible looking eye and nose, and then their mouth was just a squiggly line, and the teacher was like, okay, so the eye is incredible because not only does it match like the proportions and the shading, but like, I can barely tell that it's not actually real in front of me. They go, what about the mouth? And you go,
could use some work.
Yeah, well, no, in his world, you don't want to judge it like a piece of meat, for you just go, I got nothing to say on it. And then you go, wait, but you said that the eye was good because of how well it like reflects real life. So would that work for the mouth? And you're like, I wouldn't know. I wouldn't want to say.
Heidstop is that dude. He's that guy that that Morty had to listen to his screenplay. And, you know, he's like, do you have any thoughts? Anything? It's like, no, it was good. That's my note.
Yep.
All right, please write more. Like, that's what you want. You just want him. And then as soon as he says, like, seems a little insincere, and he's like, oh, you know what? That 3 weeks ahead teaser thing, we probably don't need it. It's like, I opened up and you took a giant shit on it. You're taking it out on me. You're a petty person. You're insecure. Your grandson is a shitty person. Leave now.
And
like
so,
all of these things.
When he says something like, it's really good that they made them more real by giving them more like real life person sort of problems to deal with, I would then be like, oh, it would be bad if they had like fake problems to deal with? Is that what you're suggesting? You know, he wouldn't be able to answer any of these questions because he doesn't want to go into the realm of bad. He's just like, no. No, they're real. They're real. Shut up. I don't have to deal with talking about why things are bad. Even though he will totally make a video about how Spider-Man 3 is terrible because Peter's not poor.
Yeah, because, you know, it's a product, even though John Watts and all of his team put their heart into it and worked really hard.
Well, yeah, we
they all worked really hard.
Just had the example of him shitting on, I guess he was shitting on Endgame?
Yeah, a bit. And that was, like, a lot of, and shitting on Hulk. In several movies, that's many thousands of people's work.
Well, imagine all the work that went into animating him, and wow, you know, careful.
Concept artists, the animators, the texture people, all those people, the rendering.
Careful,
the
high top.
Set, set up all the tech.
And you know the people who talk this kind of game, they will drop that shit like a sack of. Potatoes. No, you can drop. They will abandon that idea once you start bringing up politics.
They'll abandon it with adaptation, but they don't abandon it with specific continuity.
Which is funny, because adaptation is more bullshit.
Exactly, like, it's further away, and they feel like it's more relevant compared to the actual. Like, you know, man walks, then he just falls into a pile of sludge, and then he's walking again. You're like, well, that seems inconsistent. It's like he was a pile of sludge in the comics, and he's a man in the adaptation. That's worse. You're like, that's worse. Like what?
Yeah, it's like worse. What are you talking about? Worse.
It's a hard world to keep track of this shit.
The next sentence is, I read too many comments. I see too many other artists on this platform that ridicule and mock those who
artists. Does he always call them artists?
Why are we mocking those who share what their love? Well, we're sharing our love. We're passionately expressing our love for criticism.
He specifically said he called other artists on this platform. So talk about such an efficient way to undermine like your entire bitch fest you're doing right here.
Mm-hmm.
We're artists.
Thanks for ridiculing and mocking us.
You can't touch us, bitch.
Well, you can't. You actually can't. This is the great part is because like this is art is such a the word's kind of been tainted, but like anything that is creative expression is art. So EFAP is up.
Absolutely.
Absolutely it is.
It is art. It is because it's a craft. Criticism
and
is a craft
artists.
In and of itself.
Well, yeah, we're entertainers. Yes. We're analysts.
Or
like
writers.
What do you mean criticism? Yeah. Did someone say that in chat?
Did someone? Oh, I was just saying that criticism.
Oh, okay. Because I was about to say I would have been very disappointed.
No, I'm saying that. criticism is absolutely
like, it is
presenting, speaking. Figuring out what you think and explaining it in a way that people understand and enjoy, being funny, being humorous, trying to be expedient. All of this is like...
It's an EFAP nation. It has a flag. He's like, yeah, we have a flag now or something.
We do indeed.
I mean, we regularly... Oh, I hate that it's true, but we regularly put more thought into the script and the writing than the writers of the thing did.
It's just there is effort. There is a lot of effort that goes into.
And so he's
presenting.
Not allowed. Well, you know, maybe that he's being consistent. He didn't name us, so he's not necessarily going
sure.
after us. All right,
we're
a protected
but
class.
Anybody,
we're artists.
But this can't
well,
apply to anybody,
say,
right?
Yeah. Well, he wouldn't. There, if you asked him about it, he would never say that another YouTuber isn't an artist. He would never say that because now
he can't get away with it. No.
Yeah, he's in a situation where it either way is bad. If he says that they are artists, then we're untouchable now. If he says we're not artists, he is declaring that a thing cannot be art, and it
which
is not.
Which
art.
He would never do that.
Yes, which he would never do either.
He doesn't have the
so
balls for
he's
that.
Fucked.
Oh
yeah.
Not to mention the sentiment in isolation. Just think about this: why are we mocking those who share their love? Feel like you don't believe
you don't
that. That's
actually believe that.
Yeah. Once
you
again,
don't, you don't believe.
What? Well, I guess an easy one. Again, we go to extremes to prove these points quickly. What if someone loves cuties? Are we not going to mock them for that? Like, Maybe mock isn't even the right word, just being incredibly critical and probably involving some harsh language maybe here and there, yeah. You know?
Like I said, once politics comes out, they will abandon this point in a heartbeat. I like Trump. I like this political party. I like this policy. I like this amendment. I like this or the other thing. I like this, da-da-da-da-da. They're not going to have this, oh, everything's no. great and well, everything's fine attitude with that shit.
They would argue, though, that to have those positions... Well, Hightop literally tweeted out, if you're a Trump supporter, you're racist, right? Or did Brown Table or both of them? I can't remember.
Oh, they're both fucking dumb. Like it could have been either.
It could have been either.
Yeah, that could have been fucking both of them. But hey, that's a form of expression. That yeah, is, well, you know, stuff like look at.
Political expression absolutely yeah. is. Yeah. Well, it's all or nothing. It's all or nothing.
Yeah, we're kind of addressing how these things fundamentally are just not things he believes. But again, I almost give him some breathing room, some like, I don't know that he's learned this yet. Like, these are things that he thinks and feels.
There's no
but
pressure
he's,
to learn any of it.
Well, he's never gone to axioms. He's never thought about how these things spread into other subjects and topics. Like, how could this fucking bite me in the ass when applied to other things? Instead, he'll like the most generic one is I think good should be legal and I think bad should be illegal. That's my position. And then everyone claps, and you're like, man, that is just flawless. You are incredible.
Yeah, it's do better. It's the do better speech.
Hence why he thinks it's so profound. Does that not line up completely?
I think if you watch that speech and think it's profound, like that's it.
You are a simpleton.
Well, yes. Yeah,
you are an absolute fucking simpleton.
Thank you for telling me how little you understand about the way that the world works. Like that is very helpful for me. But it's just like it's important, guys. Like in general, to really interrogate the reason why you believe the things that you do. Like on everything. Figure it out, whittle it down to its base. And of course, when it comes to like movie analysis, it's one thing, but like I would say in general, you should just do this with any position that you have. You need to be able to like interrogate it from every perspective to figure out where your principles bend, where there are holes that you need to fill, or whether or not you even need to change your perspective fundamentally and reconcile why you feel the way that you feel and whether or not that's even like valid. Because the reality is that like sticking to your principles sometimes means denying the emotional feeling that you have in favor of something that you know is better reasoned.
So next up.
Yeah, next line is, there is nothing that comes from spewing hate, which you definitely don't believe that.
Which I don't agree with that.
And would you not agree as well, we've entered into, when you use the word spewing, it feels like when a narrator is very objective yeah. and then suddenly says, these people are evil. You're like, wait a minute.
Literally, spewing. All Trump supporters are racist. It's like, well, oh, well, that's not helpful.
This came across more fundamental, and now he's like, spewing hate. And you're like, wait a minute. Like,
right, yeah,
you were describing it as hate too. Like, I just, oh, this suddenly got very,
That's my form yeah. of expression you're talking about there. Yeah,
you. As he says, there is nothing that comes from spewing hate and then hiding that hate behind quote unquote critique. I'm still learning this lesson. It's fun being a dick and roasting something. But there is always people behind the writing you read, the videos you watch, the art you consume. Yes, that's true. Think about it, Hightop. Think about it.
There are always people behind the delivery of artistic works.
Yes,
such as
there
this.
Are always people behind the people who are spewing hate and hiding it behind criticism. Because it's not spewed by, like, the air. It's not spewed by a tree. Think about it, Hightop. It's just worth, and no, it's, and no, artist, and no, fuck, it's so small that I can't even tell if there's a comment there. And no artist has ever set out to make something that gets called bad by idiots like myself on YouTube. Now, I like that, because it feels like he's trying to cloak the insult directed at other people by saying, no, it's like me, I'm self-deprecating.
No, it's me, this is a self-critique. Yeah, it's
about
myself.
Me, it's not
yeah.
about other people.
Well, no, dude, I don't know if there's a word for it, but it's cloaking a compliment to yourself in a criticism. So an example would be, Springy operates in a particular way every single day of his life. I meet him and go, I also have made that mistake. I don't anymore, but I used to.
Yeah.
You're like,
Yeah, it's like a backhanded compliment in a way.
I think Just Right said to me and Wolf that he used to look at art the way we do when he was younger. It's like... Oh, yeah, thanks,
then
buddy.
He fucking degraded into sludge.
The thing that amuses me about it isn't like, oh, that was just a bareface. It's like, do you not even register that that was an insult? Are you that stupid? Like, you just said something incredibly condescending, or do you think
he's
you got away with it?
Past insults.
I think he thinks he got away with it, that we didn't even notice. It's like, haha, that was quite witty of me, if I say so myself.
What is the final sentence here? If you somehow read all this, thank you. Thank you for watching, smiley face. Oh, yeah.
If you somehow read this, it's like, but it,
why did
you can clearly read it. It's just the effort of just zooming in.
Well, I find it more frustrating than that, because this was, you know, look at it. It's all floompy. It's like, why the hell did you make it so hard to read for, like, the average person? Like if you just look at because, like, not everybody's going to even want to do it.
You know what? Honestly, that's a little ableist to make it so small that nobody can read that. And I'm kind of not even bullshitting. Like, it's a little bit fucked to make it so small.
Yeah,
can't read it.
Yeah, do they not deserve to hear this? And if you believe it, why would you make it so difficult to read? Why would you say if you actually managed to, you know, why? Who's
what
supposed
if I couldn't
see this
actually
message?
Manage to read it? Do you not thank me if I was literally incapable of reading it because it was so small?
That's the meme for this.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, that's the meme.
Good old community.
Oh, God, we are not going to get all four of these done.
Hey, well, you know what? That was like a detour back to High Top's video, because I saw someone say there's no need to read this because he basically just reads it out going forward. So if he does, we'll be able to mostly skip over this.
Oh, boy.
Let's have a look.